You're watching the free version of Mocha Essentials. Follow along with projects and footage with a premium download available at borisfx.com. Well, welcome to the wonderful world of rotoscoping. And this is the shot that we're going to be tackling over the next few exercises. Now, one of the important things that we're going to be doing when we're going to be doing this rotoscoping job is to not try to eat too much in one bite. So the most important thing that we're going to be starting with is to look at our object and see how we can start to break this down and what order that we're going to want to break these shapes up into as well. Now, there is no one definitive way of doing rotoscoping. There's certainly an art to it. I'll be here showing you my way of rotoscoping and the little tricks and techniques that we've got in Mocha to help speed things along. So let's pop into our working comp and I will apply Mocha. As before, we're using Mocha Pro, but 99% of the things that I'm going to show you in the next few exercises are going to be possible with any version of Mocha that you're working with. So let's come in and play back our shot. Now, this is in fact the most important stage of Roto. It's the first couple of minutes where you just play back your shot back and forth and just look at it. And you're going to start to study it and, you know, figure out where the motion is and what you need to do. It's at this point where we start reflecting about the shot and kind of understanding where it's coming from. So I'm just going to pause this for a second so that we don't get seasick, because I'm going to talk you through a few things. Now, to start with, I look for what I need to cut out. Here we're going to be wanting to do a full roto of the girl. And I need to check out any sort of movement that we have that is going to cause trouble later on. Now, we have movement of the arms that go off screen. That's worth noting. We also have movement of the face that reveals a side of the face that we can't see at the very start. That's interesting. And we also have hair. Now, hair can be a very big task all on its own, but I'm looking at the notes that the supervisor's given me, and I realize that the hair doesn't need every single strand created. I can get away with just having the general outline of the hair. So lucky me, and lucky us. I'm also going to draw attention to the sunglasses, which are off the face, and move around along with the face. So that's kind of interesting. And the final thing to note isn't about the movement within our subject. It's about movement within the shot. Is our shot moving? If you just look at it back here, like with a casual eye would say, oh no, it's a static shot. But obviously it's not 100% static, because look at our background here. The camera is moving a little bit. Now, in normal circumstances, if we're just watching this, that kind of camera movement is very easy to ignore, but not when we're rotoscoping. When we're rotoscoping and creating these splines, every single movement within the frame is going to be important to us. And what seems like just a very small, minor amount of camera movement can cause us a huge amount of headaches and extra work if we're not aware of what the camera is doing. So to break it down one last time, we have moving camera, we have moving subject, we have areas going off screen, and we have areas being revealed later in the shot. So all in all, this fairly straightforward shot has a lot of small individual elements that could cause trouble when we're rotoscoping. But with that in mind, let's have a look at the first shapes we want to create. I'm going to work front to back here. So the elements that are closest to the camera are going to be the ones that I focus on first. And we'll understand why in the coming exercises. So let's start with the arm here. Now, note when I say let's start with the arm, I'm talking about a very specific part of the arm. I'm going to look at the forearm, because we don't want to make too big and complicated a shape. as you can see here, when the hand moves down, because it's 3D, it's starting to change shape, and we're going to deal with that as a separate item. So let's draw our forearm shape. Now, what I'm looking for here is not to take in the entire shape at all. So I'll just use the X-spline to draw a rough outline and then close it up using right click. But let's see. I mean, if I wanted to, you know, get a really nice shape on this, wouldn't it make sense to actually get a nice shape on it straight away? Well, yes and no. Now, the way that I'm going to do this and the way that I usually do these types of roto tasks within Mocha is to create some rough shapes that are just there for tracking. So these are our tracker layers. These are our helper layers. And these are going to drive the actual mask shapes, the roto splines that I want a little bit later. So up in the layers palette, I'm going to call this one forearm. I'm going to call this one left, even though it's her right arm. It's screen left. It's usually easier to think of it like that. And it's going to be a track. So now when I'm doing a load of these, I'll just write TR for track. But because we're just starting, I'm going to write the whole thing track. Okay, and let's come down here and look at our track motion options and cast our minds back to the dim and distant past of exercise 3, when we're first starting to talk about Mocha's planar tracker and what track options are going to be best suited for certain things. Now, remember, when we were talking about skew, we usually used it in the context of organic shapes. And this is a perfect example of an organic shape. It's a shape that is going to move and bulge a little bit. So we're not going to be best served using perspective, which is mainly going to give us, you know, perfect results for flat objects. So I'm going to go skew instead, and this should be enough. And let's just track this forwards and see what we get. And at some point, it's going to go off screen. And we got pretty far. So we got to 1 second and 2 frames, and then it terminated. That's fine. It got further than I expected it to. So I'm going to come into layer properties here, and I'm going to set my out point. And we're going to be doing this quite a bit because we don't want all of these shapes being on screen all the time. We're going to be using our in and out points on the layer properties a lot more than we have done up till now. We'll come back into the Essentials tab now. And with our forearm track done, I'm going to turn off visibility on it. I'm going to turn off tracking on it as well. And let's draw our real shape. So for our real shape, I'm going to be a little bit more accurate around the edges. Now I want to keep these shapes as simple as possible. And we're going to be using our zoom and pan around keyboard shortcuts a lot. So that's going to be X for pan and Z for zoom. So press and hold down X to pan around. Press and hold down Z to zoom in and out. And as soon as we let go, we go back to the tool we were previously in. Now, I want to make this shape as simple as possible. And I want to impress that on you as much as I possibly can. The simpler the shape, the easier it's going to be to animate, and the better the end result is going to be. So take a little look here. Now let's look at this left-hand side, for example. Because we're rotoscoping the entire body, I really don't need to have a huge amount of detail or a huge amount of accuracy on this side here past the first few frames. As soon as the arm goes entirely in front of the body, which is where we're going to have the rest of our mask anyway, I don't really mind if we're not 100% accurate on that. Over on the right-hand side, it's much more important that we do get a little bit more sort of pixel perfect is going to be maybe overkill, but a lot more accurate on this side. Now, because we're using an X-spline, I can right-click on any of our handles here. If we move our mouse to the left or our pen to the left, if using pen and tablet, that will soften down all of the points simultaneously. So when doing this sort of soft organic roto, X-spline is by far the best choice for us because it offers that mix of accuracy that we can get with just, you know, a single point and the tension on the handle here, but it also means that because we're only dealing with 2 points, it's going to be a lot easier and a lot smoother when it comes to animating these in. If we were using a Bezier shape, like you often find with the pen tool, that has 3 points, so it has a center point and two handles, and that can get a little bit trickier to control when we start to animate them in. Okay, so I am happy with my first shape. I'm so happy, I'm going to give this a name, and I'm going to call this one forearm left mask. And when I'm doing lots of these, I will just call this one M for mask. So we have TR for track, M for mask. Now let's link our shape to the track. So we come down to link to track and go link to track there. And we'll see that it now turns blue, meaning that we have tracking data associated with it. And this is really useful because we have this separation between tracking data and shape data. So if we take a little look down here, we can see actually when the arm did go off screen, it did start to shorten up a little bit. So it has created a slightly different look than we want. But in the general context, especially for the start where we need it to be nice and accurate, it's absolutely fine. So when it comes to about here, it starts to break down a little bit, but that's okay. So just in this first part, we've actually covered quite a lot of the fundamental ideas, but let's do one more before we take a quick break. This last point here is to start adding keyframes. And where do we start to add the keyframes? Now we could start to add one just where it starts to go wrong, which would be about here. Or we could add one just when the tracking is finished as well. But I sort of want to kind of do something in the middle and sort of catch it before it goes too wrong, because there is a frame here where if we look at the bottom right-hand corner, it's right, then it goes wrong. Now, I want to catch the last good frame. Now, this concept of a last good frame is going to be very important for us later. Not so much with this shape, because this shape is fairly simple. But when we get to more complex shapes, I'm going to be hammering on the idea of this last good frame. And here is our last good frame. Is it perfect? No, but it's good. So I'm just going to change one point here. And we can see up at the top, it's also missed a little bit there. So I'm going to change a little point there. This just gets us back into everything lining up really nicely. And if we play that backwards, that all fits in really well. And we look at the timeline, I can now see I've got one keyframe at the start and one keyframe at frame 16. So the idea here is that we touch our shape as little as possible. And when we do have to touch the shape, we work large to small. And I'm going to leave you hanging with that idea until the next exercise, because that's where we're going to start to pick it up again from. So in this first part of the introduction to rotoscoping, we've figured out that the most important thing before we even start to do any sort of shapes at all is to play our shot back on loop or ping pong and just start to analyze what our shot is doing. And we're analyzing it for movement of the different shapes, figuring out which shapes are going to be complex to do and which shapes are going to be easy to do, and also looking to see if there is any movement within the camera as well, because that's another thing that could trip us up later. Once we've done that analysis phase, we then created our first shape, which was our tracking shape. This was nice and loose because we were using it to drive our real shape. And this is going to be tighter and more accurate, as we can see with just our first two frames. So I'm going to save this here. We'll take a little break, go and grab a cup of tea or coffee. And when we come back, we're going to be finishing off with the left forearm and seeing what differences, if any, are going to be made on the right forearm. So see you back in just a minute's time.
You've been watching the free version of Mocha Essentials. To download all videos, projects, and footage, purchase the premium version available at borisfx.com.